Well, it's such a pleasure to be here this evening. And by the way, I just came back 2 weeks ago from an expedition to see a total solar eclipse with a few of you in the audience. And so now I'm up to 14. Now, you might say this one was a bit unfair because I saw it from an airplane, and so the weather was guaranteed to be good, right, above the clouds. But not so. It could have been so windy at the airport that we might not have been allowed to take off. We were stuck at the gate for an hour upon landing in Reykjavik, Iceland, because it was so windy. So, you know, things are always a little bit up in the air. But I'm 14 for 14. I choose wisely whenever I go see an eclipse, okay? Anyway, Luke and a few others, Laura, are here, and we reminisced a little bit during the cocktail hour about our trip. Anyway, it's a particular pleasure to see so many of you here as members of the Charter Hill Society. We so much value what you do for Cal. We want it to remain the number one public university in the world, even though the word public is beginning to diminish, in a sense, from its vocabulary, given the declining state support. My own feeling is the state is disinvesting in higher education. They're looking at the short-term prospects for economic gain and not looking at the long-term prospects that come 20, 30, 40 years later when our illustrious alumni make it in the world. So, you know, we really, really need your help. And we thank you for your support. And I thank you for being here to listen to what I have to say on exploding stars and new planets and a little bit about black holes, frontier research at Lick Observatory. Much of that research being done by Cal people. Go Bears, okay? I mean, the other UC campuses are doing excellent research there too, but I would say that at Lick Observatory, Cal is actually leading the way. So, the Lick Observatory is owned and operated by the University of California system. It's right here in the Bay Area, just 14 miles east of San Jose, as the crow flies. Now, as the car wanders along the contours of the hills there, it's more like 19 miles, and there are 365 turns, supposedly one for each day of the year. And, you know, it's not a very steep road because everything was brought up by horse and carriage more than a century ago. Indeed, it was completed in 1888, at least in its initial form. And at that time, it was the world's first remote astronomical observatory. Before that time, telescopes were on university campuses, which tended to be in big cities at or near sea level. But in 1888, this thing was really quite remote, all right? And you could say that it was the birth of big science, certainly in the Western United States and arguably in the entire United States. This was one of the first, if not the first, big science projects. And it was made possible because of an eccentric fellow, James Lick, after whom many things are named here in the Bay Area. And I could give a whole lecture on the colorful history of Lick. I won't do that. Suffice it to say that he came to California in 1848, already with considerable wealth, and with the good fortune of arriving 17 days before gold was discovered at Sutter's Mill. Yes, 17 days before gold was discovered. And he tried his hand for 3 or 4 days panning for gold, and he realized this is just not the profession for him. And he realized that, you know, real estate is where it's at, because a lot of people were leaving San Francisco to go hunt for gold, and, you know, they were willing to get rid of their land for a small amount of money, and then he happily sold it back to them after they came back, you know. And of course, the gold rush brought a tremendous influx of people to California, and so this little town of Yerba Buena of 2000 in 1848 suddenly was a booming city of 20,000 a mere 3 years later. And guess who sold the land to all of these people coming in? James Lick. So he became very, very wealthy. He owned significant parts of California, okay? Santa Catalina Island and many other things. The bills looked a bit different back then, but anyway. So near the end of his life, you know, he had no heirs, and he was thinking about what to do with his wealth. And he had a number of ideas. He greatly honored his parents and all that they stood for, and so he wanted to build statues of them and himself to be placed on Ocean Beach, much like the Moai on Easter Island. Yeah, standing there looking west. but he was told that if we are ever attacked from the West, these will be among the first structures to fall because they would be so obvious. So he said, yeah, that's true. You know. So how about, he said, I build a pyramid at the corner of 4th and Market Streets in San Francisco. Or maybe it's 5th and Market. I mean, he owned most of San Francisco, so he actually could do whatever he wanted, right? But he was told that, look, you know, pyramids are nothing new. They're in Mexico, they're in Egypt, they're in Central America. You know, they're kind of cool, but they're not really useful, and they wouldn't be uniquely James Lick, right? So he was given the idea by members of the California Academy of Sciences of perhaps donating his money to the construction of the world's largest and greatest telescope. And although James Lick appears not to have had any significant interest in astronomy at the time, he became convinced that such a telescope would be useful to scientists, to society, and a fitting monument to himself and to his parents. So in 1875, he gave a gift of $700,000 for the construction of this world's greatest telescope. As a fraction of the GDP, that is the equivalent of $1.2 billion today. It is the largest gift ever, I believe, certainly to astronomy and possibly to all of the physical sciences. I'm not sure of the biomedical sciences. But anyway, it was a gigantic gift. And the telescope was indeed built. There it is, the 36-inch diameter Great Lick refractor. And it's got this moving floor that you can elevate and move down through a hydraulic press down below. And below the pier of the telescope, below the floor, is indeed James Lick's tomb. Here lies the body of James Lick. And in times of greater funding, I think these flowers were changed every once in a while. Now they're fake. But you know, hardly anyone goes down there, so who cares? I mean, I'm actually bringing my students, a select subset of my 800 students in my introductory course, I'm bringing them up to Lick this Saturday to take a look at the tomb and to do other things. But anyway, you know, no one really goes down there, so it was a bit of a waste of money to spend on you know, living or newly cut flowers every few days. Graduate students like to play tricks on visiting astronomers back in the day when this telescope was used for research, and they would be under the floor at midnight, you know, rattling the chains and wreaked havoc to some of the visiting astronomers who were not aware that this was all just tall tales of ghosts and stuff. Well, at age 127, you might think, what good is Lick Observatory? I mean, it's pretty old for a scientific facility. But you know, we've kept up with the times, as I'll explain, and Lick now remains a vital, productive, and in many ways unique facility for certain types of astronomical research, education, instrumentation development, and public outreach. And it's because, you know, the Great Refractor is not the only instrument there. We have many other telescopes there, some of which are very, very new. In fact, this one here, which I'll describe, is only about a year and a half old. These telescopes are not large by today's standards. And indeed, you know, I'm very privileged to use the twin Keck 10-meter telescopes on Mauna Kea volcano in Hawaii, an extinct or at least highly dormant volcano. You know, the geologists at Cal had better be right. If this thing ever blows up, we'll be kind of upset at them and they will lose tenure, you know. But they tell us that, you know, the volcanic activity has moved on to Kilauea and this new island coming up. So this is a highly dormant volcano, high in the middle of the ocean, very few lights, very nice, stable conditions, wonderful facility. I love it. And again, I'm privileged to use it quite a lot. It's owned and operated by Caltech and UC jointly. And we are now planning a 30-meter telescope, and in fact, formally, Canada just signed on. We just heard the news yesterday. And that's a large international collaboration, but you know, it's a big bucks project. It's 1.2, 1.3 billion, you know. And this telescope will be even more powerful than the Keck's, and with it, we'll be able to study some faint little smudge that may or may not be the world's first or the universe's first galaxy in the process of forming. You know, tremendously exciting, and I hope to get some time on that telescope. But the time is going to be very precious. I'll be lucky if I get one night per year as a UC faculty member, and I get a few nights per year at Keck. And so I do certain types of projects, as do my colleagues, with the biggest, most unique telescopes. But it doesn't mean there aren't other really useful projects to be done with the smaller, more modest-sized telescopes. And as you will see, those are the projects where young people, students and young postdoctoral scholars can contribute and learn to become independent scientists. So what I want to show you tonight is a sampling of the outstanding current and future research that is being done at Lick Observatory. And I have time for just a few sort of highlights, one of which will be something I work on quite a lot, supernovae. Another one will be something that's exciting, but I don't happen to work on. That's planets around other stars. And then I'll mention black holes, because you can't give a talk about astronomy without, you know, speaking about black holes. They're out there in the news a lot. So let me just talk about exploding stars. Our own sun will not explode at the end of its life. It'll die more or less quietly. But a small minority of stars explode violently at the end of their lives in a titanic, cataclysmic act of self-destruction, which actually allows us to exist, as I will discuss in a few minutes. So here's the action sped up considerably. A single star in this galaxy of perhaps 100 billion stars brightening over the course of a couple of weeks, fading over months and years. But at its peak, it's the equivalent of the central billion stars in this galaxy. So it's like a billion suns. If our sun were to do this, and it won't, don't worry, be happy, but sunblock of 50 just wouldn't cut it, folks. You'd need sunblock or supernova block of a few billion to protect yourself, all right? Now, why these things are important, besides just being fun to look at, is that during the explosions, you eject into the cosmos new heavy elements that were synthesized through nuclear reactions during the normal course of the star's life and during the explosive stage itself. So through fusion, what you get are things like carbon and oxygen and calcium and iron, things that are important to humans, and they're ejected by these explosions, producing chemically enriched gases which then expand over the course of thousands of years. And here's the Crab Nebula, a supernova remnant that's about 1,000 years old. And by an analysis of those gases, we can tell that it's been enriched considerably over the hydrogen and helium with which the star was initially born. So there's carbon in these gases, like the carbon in your cells. There's oxygen, like the oxygen that you breathe and that's in water. There's calcium, like in your bones. There's iron, like in your red blood cells. And those gases then, those chemically enriched gases, expand outward for thousands of years, gradually mixing with other gases from other exploding stars, gradually forming new stars as a result of first coagulating into gigantic clouds like this one, the Orion Nebula, which become so massive that they're gravitationally bound and they start collapsing. And in the inner parts, we can see newly formed stars or stars that are still forming. And around those stars, you can see disks of debris, of gas and fine particulate matter that we call dust, that's in the process of forming planets. And this would not be possible, at least not for rocky Earth-like planets, unless there had been many previous generations of stellar birth, stellar death through these explosions, renewed birth, renewed death, and so on, gradually over the billions of years, increasing the proportion of the heavy elements, because the universe was born only with hydrogen and helium. So we needed this process to precede us for billions of years in order to form a rocky Earth-like planet, okay? And on Earth, at least, maybe elsewhere, life formed and it evolved. I'm skipping a few stages here. And finally, sentient beings with the intellectual capacity to ask questions about our very origins and devise experiments and observations to answer those questions. How did DNA, how did life arise? What is it made of? And by the way, here's a little bit of my DNA by the model of DNA at the Lawrence Hall of Science. Those are my four children, okay? So anyway, I'm continually astounded that humans have the curiosity and the intellect and the mechanical ability to build machines, okay, so that through thought and observation and collecting of data, they can and are answering such fundamental questions. And I feel incredibly privileged to have been part of that process. So we want to understand these explosions more closely in order to have a better idea of how we came to be and what the future of the Milky Way galaxy is and so on. But stars explode only rarely in a galaxy like this, maybe 2 or 3 times per century. So if I were a really cruel advisor, I would have each of my students staring through the eyepiece of the James Lick Great Refractor at one and only one galaxy, preferably at night. You see more galaxies and stars at night than during the day. This is a staged shot. And when that student discovers a supernova, he or she gets a pat on the back, and we let them graduate and move on to greener pastures. Meanwhile, I will have had decades worth of slave labor from said student. Now, some crimes are so egregious that even a tenured professor can and should get fired, and that would be one such crime. I can't take advantage of students in this way. I mean, you know, they need to study, they need to sleep, and most importantly, they need to party, I guess. So, but I could, you know, have them look at thousands of galaxies, because, you know, if there's a couple of supernovae per galaxy per century, then if you look at thousands of galaxies, you improve your odds of finding them. But that would be considered cruel and unusual punishment as well. I can't just have them staring through the eyepiece of a telescope night after night after night. Fortunately, with modern technology, we have a better technique. We attach digital cameras, like the cameras all of you use, to the eyepiece end of a telescope. We take photographs of thousands of galaxies, and then we simply look for arrows. And where you see an arrow, you see an exploding star. Oh, it works. Look, it happened once, twice, 3 times, 4 times, 5 times. By rigorous mathematical induction, I conclude that this process works every time. That's how you find exploding stars. Well, obviously, it can't be that easy. Otherwise, we wouldn't give degrees for this kind of work. What we have done is we've developed a rather small by today's standards, but robotic telescope called KATE, the Katzmann Automatic Imaging Telescope at Lick Observatory. And it's been programmed to take photographs of nearly 10,000 galaxies each week, over 1,000 galaxies per night. And then it repeats the process with the same galaxies. And it also automatically compares the new pictures with the old pictures. And usually there's nothing new in the new picture, but occasionally you do see something new. See that arrow there? It didn't used to be there. Well, okay. We stuck that in with Photoshop or something. But it's pointing to an object that used to not be there. And that becomes a supernova candidate. We don't know that it's an exploding star for sure. We have to study it some more. It could, for example, be an asteroid flying through the field of view with Earth's name written on it. And by the way, someday astronomers will find that asteroid 30 or 40 years before it hits us, and then clever engineers and applied physicists will figure out a way to deflect it. The key here is early detection. You know, you don't want to detect it when it's about to hit you. You want to detect it decades ahead of time when you can do something about it. But anyway, one person's garbage is another person's gold. My group isn't interested in the asteroids. We study the supernovae. And so I have a group of students, Cal students, who, with their superior eye-brain combination, examine the few dozen candidates that we get each night and determine which ones are likely to be genuine exploding stars worthy of further consideration. And they get their hands dirty with research early on. I get freshmen, sophomores interested, occasionally even a high school student. And you wouldn't imagine what a thrill it is for them to help with the discovery of a supernova. They always write home to mom about it. We credit them with the discovery in telegrams that we send out. These students get early exposure to research. And many, in fact, probably most of them, don't go on to become PhDs in astrophysics. That's okay. We don't need too many replacements, okay? But they go on in fields that are more immediately useful to society: computer science, applied physics, engineering, things like that. But, you know, when they were kids, what turned them on was discoveries about the cosmos, and they got their early research experience by working with, for example, my team. And so it's really a great, great opportunity for them. And I now have like a dozen undergrads. That's only half of my team. But the key to this type of research was that my team needs huge amounts of time on small or modest-sized telescopes. they can do the job much more cheaply and efficiently than the gigantic telescopes, which shouldn't be used for this kind of work because, in a sense, it's too easy for them. Why would you spend $1 billion building the 30-meter telescope only to look at relatively nearby galaxies in search of bright exploding stars when I can do it with a telescope that's this big, you know, and cost $500,000 at most? So that's the kind of thing, you know, you can't do it all with the big telescopes, or you shouldn't. Once we or other people find the supernovae, we want to study them in greater detail. We then use a bigger telescope, like the 3-meter telescope at LIC. We collect the light. We send the light through a prism, producing a rainbow or a spectrum. This procedure of spectroscopy teaches lots of interesting things to all kinds of scientists, biologists, chemists, physicists, astronomers use spectroscopy. You can learn about the chemical composition of the gases in the supernova. You can learn how quickly the supernova is expanding. You can learn what kind of star exploded. So spectroscopy is one of the keys. And when we plot the brightness as a function of color or wavelength, we get a plot that looks like this: brightness or intensity versus wavelength. This is blue light down here. This is red light here. This stuff is what's called the near infrared. And you can see that the spectrum looks like a roller coaster. It's got all these bumps and wiggles. And we've learned to identify the cause of the bumps and wiggles. Here you have calcium atoms, oxygen, silicon, sulfur, iron, magnesium, more calcium. These are the elements that were cooked up prior to and during the explosion of this star. These are the elements that later might produce an Earth-like planet and maybe even life elsewhere in the cosmos. Here's another type of supernova. You know, astronomers are pretty boring people. We could have called them Fred and Jean, but we call them type 1 and type 2. And the type 1s have different subtypes, type 1a, for example, which are particularly near and dear to my heart. Anyway, we find these guys in nearby galaxies, and we can study them in great detail. You don't want to just take one spectrum of a supernova. You want to take a spectrum of the supernova every night or every few nights, because as the ejected gases expand, you see more and more deeply into the innards of this exploding star. And you get like a CAT scan of the star so that you can see which elements are on the outside and which elements are on the inside. And indeed, you can tell that the carbon and the light guys are on the outside and the iron is on the inside. And the way you can tell is by taking a bunch of spectra here. These are ordered in terms of increasing age, where the negative signs simply mean 12 days before the supernova reached its peak. That's just a technicality. But anyway, we cut this thing 2 weeks before it reached peak brightness. We got spectra for a while, every day or every few days, by calling up our friends on the LIC 3-meter telescope and saying, hey, would you mind just spending 10 minutes out of your important night and getting a spectrum for us? And here's the reason why. And my colleagues are happy to do this in general. And I'm happy to repay the favor if they have some pressing issue that they're studying during one of my nights, because the time is relatively easy to get. It's not so precious. You know, it's not like Hubble Space Telescope time, for which my proposals are due this Friday. And, you know, if I'm lucky, one proposal out of 10 will get accepted. The oversubscription is that competitive, you know. And, you know, if the observations don't work out, tough, you know. Here, the time is just much more relaxed. It's our telescope. It's a bunch of UC colleagues. We trade time around all the time. And indeed, you can see the spectrum changes. The details don't matter from your perspective, but you can see that the shapes are changing with time. And this is telling us what's going on inside the supernova. And again, students are heavily involved in this work from an early age, all right, because it's not that hard to get them involved and to have them be trained on a telescope where, you know, they can make a mistake. We all make mistakes, but students to learn need to make more mistakes than someone who's had decades of training like I have. And, you know, it's just too expensive to have them make mistakes on the most expensive, precious telescopes. So you have them learn how to do science on the facilities that are less in demand, in a sense. In addition to the spectra, we monitor the brightness as a function of time. And here you see a type 1a, here's a type 2. This simply tells us that there's different physics going on. Okay, I look at those light curves and I know what's going on inside. But again, small telescopes are involved. We don't want just one measurement every month. We want measurements every night or every other night. And that can be done with a small telescope, a 1 meter telescope at Lick Observatory, which students run. And in fact, in the past 5 to 7 years, a really great thing has happened in the UC system. At each of the campuses that has an astrophysics program, we have set up remote observing rooms. In other words, the students are connected up with the observatory from their home campus. This is fantastic, because students generally don't have cars, and they can't rent cars, and it's a 4-hour round trip from Berkeley or Santa Cruz, and it's a flight from UCLA or UC San Diego or Irvine. So it's just hard for undergrads to get involved in getting the data unless they can do so from their home campuses. Now they can. So now undergraduate research and participation in Lick studies has just shot up skyward like never before because of these remote observing rooms. And my own team is pretty large. I have a weekly lunch where I bring pizza and they justify their existence for the previous week. And, you know, we discuss the various, you know, projects we've been doing, so it's a lot of fun. But again, to get these light curves, to get sets of spectra, you need to have huge amounts of time on small or modest-sized telescopes. And you'll see that this is the mantra, you know, for the whole talk. All right, well, it turns out that by studying nearby ones and by finding and studying their very distant counterparts, about 17 years ago, two teams of which I was a member were able to trace the expansion history of the universe, and we realized that the universe is expanding faster now than it used to. And that's strange because gravity pulls. I should have been using an apple, but I forgot my apple. And so you expect the universe to be slowing down, but we found that it is speeding up, and that's the subject of a full-length talk on its own, so I don't want to do that now. But the point is that this led to the discovery of the accelerating universe, which was deemed the single most important discovery in all areas of science in 1998. And since that time, lots of people have verified this, have made additional measurements, and we now know that what's driving the expansion, or what we think is driving the expansion, is weird stuff called dark energy. And it's like an anti-gravitating effect. And until we did these measurements with supernovae, it wasn't known. So this whole slice of the cosmic pie was not known until we did our measurements. The only thing that we knew about were dark matter, which is also weird, and ordinary matter, which is not so weird, okay? So the pie used to be ordinary matter and dark matter. And before astronomers realized that there was dark matter, the whole pie was ordinary matter, you know, the 92 naturally occurring elements. And now we found that, in fact, the modern day cosmic pie is totally different from what you were taught on your mother's knee when you were in school and when you were taught about the periodic table of the elements. And this is just so exciting. And so this discovery has opened up whole new areas of physics. Indeed, it has revolutionized physics. There's a cottage industry of people now trying to figure out what dark energy was. So in recognition of the importance of the discovery of the accelerating expansion of the universe, the discovery was honored with the 2011 Nobel Prize in Physics, which was really a great, great thing. The only problem was that because of old rules by which the prize is governed, at most 3 people are given the prize, and big science these days is always a team effort, and that's something Alfred Nobel could not have foreseen a century ago. So the Nobel winners themselves were Saul Perlmutter, a professor at Cal, yay, and Brian Schmidt, a professor at the Australian National University, and my former postdoc, Adam Rees, who did the work with me when I mentored him in the mid to late 90s. So in fact, in a sense, the two of us for Schmidt's team were the first to realize what the data were telling us. And he really was the first. And so for 10 years, I had been campaigning for him. And I'm glad the Nobel Committee did the right thing and honored him along with the two official leaders of the teams. But anyway, it's just you never know what you're going to find. And never in my wildest dreams did I think that I would ever be associated with such an important discovery. OK, the other main science topic is exoplanets, planets orbiting other stars. it addresses a fundamental question: are there other planetary systems? Are any of them like our own solar system? It turns out it's hard to detect planets directly because they're really small and they reflect very little light from the star that they orbit. But because they orbit the star also moves. It turns out that a more correct statement is that two bodies orbit their common center of mass. So the planet moves a lot because it has a low mass, and the star moves a little bit because it has a high mass. And so when the planet is moving away from us, the star will be moving toward us. And if you take its spectrum, you will notice that the light has been squished. It's been shifted to shorter wavelengths. It's a little bit like a siren coming toward you. The pitch sounds high, the wavelength is low. And when it's going away from you, the pitch sounds low because the wavelength is large. And it goes eeeah, like that. Well, in a similar way, the star is going eeeah, eeeah, eeeah as it goes back and forth toward us and away from us in response to the orbiting planet going away from us and toward us. It just does the opposite. It's this kind of a thing. And if you take a series of spectra where you see all these little absorption lines and you monitor it over the course of several weeks or months, you can see that those lines move around. They're being shifted by different amounts, different Doppler shifts. And in fact, we've greatly exaggerated the effect here. The actual shift is about 1/1000th of a pixel. That's really hard to measure, but it has been measured. And here you can see some actual data: the speed of the star toward us or away from us. Sorry, this is away and this is toward, as a function of time. And you see that the points bounce around. They don't just sit at zero. And the astronomers doing this noticed that they could fit a periodic function through the data points. And right around here, they started suspecting that they've got something interesting. So they took a bunch of data, a bunch more data here. That looked promising. So right around now, they decided to really pour it on and take a lot of data. And that revealed something orbiting the star with a period of 7/10 of a year and having a mass of roughly 2 Jupiter masses. So this is an exoplanet. And then on top of this, you see a periodic modulation that has a period of 4 years, and that happens to be caused by a planet having roughly 4 times the mass of Jupiter. And in these data, but removed from this plot, was a very rapid oscillation caused by a planet orbiting with a period of only 4.6 days. So it's very close to the star, it's just buzzing around. It's fantastic. It's called a hot Jupiter, is what it's called. So placed on our solar system, here's Mercury, Venus, and Earth. These blue dotted lines, I hope you can see them. Here's where these other planets would be if plotted on the same scale. So this is a star called Upsilon Andromedae, and it has a triple planet system. So that's really, really exciting. But to get the evidence that there's a planet orbiting a star and the star is moving a little bit in response to it, getting 1 or 2 nights a year on the world's biggest telescopes does no good whatsoever. You need lots and lots of time, huge amounts of time on telescopes where that time is available, smaller, modest-sized telescopes. And in fact, my colleague, Professor Jeff Marcy at Cal, used the LIC 3-meter telescope to find 70 of the first 100 known exoplanets, along with his, at that time, postdoctoral scholar, Paul Butler. And when the first few were found, it was big news. How the discovery of two planets brings us closer to solving the most profound mystery in the cosmos. Cover of Time magazine, you know, is anybody out there? A big time story, because, you know, Dole drops, Clinton rises, that kind of thing happens every 4 years, you know. But how often do we find evidence that might bring us closer to answering the question of whether anyone else is out there? That's cosmic, folks. Now you might say, well, wait, you've read evidence that the answer has already been found. In fact, you've seen, you know, noteworthy and reliable periodicals like Weekly World News, where they announce confidently, alien backs Arnold for governor. Hasta la vista, Gray Davis, you know. So, well, don't believe everything you read, and I don't think I have to tell this crowd that, you know. This is hardly a peer-reviewed journal. Anyway, you know, these things have been found. Someday we hope to get close up and build big telescopes with which we'll get images. This is just an artist's impression. A lot of the planets that have been found up to now are big, gaseous, Jupiter-like planets. That's exciting, but more exciting still would be to find Earth-like planets, small, rocky planets with continents and oceans, because those kinds of planets might harbor indigenous, independent life, right? And that would bring us closer to answering this question. Well, you know, Earth isn't very massive, so it causes the sun to wobble only a little bit. The speed of the sun's motion induced by Earth's orbit is 10 centimeters per second. That's about like that, okay? That's a very small motion. Jupiter causes a motion of 10 meters per second, okay, versus 10 centimeters. So, you know, gonna be hard to find little tiny planets like this. You're gonna need really huge amounts of time on smaller, modest-sized telescopes to build up the signal and drown out the noise. You know, when you make just a few measurements, you don't know what's signal, you don't know what's noise. You gotta take lots and lots of data to see what's real. And so, you know, Professor Marcy said, well, you know, he can't get enough time on the LIC 3-meter telescope because people like me are using it to study exploding stars. So he said, okay, he's gonna build his own telescope, which he actually allows me to use once in a while to study exploding stars. But this is a brand new telescope, the size of the Hubble Space Telescope, dedicated to monitoring the brightest nearby stars over and over again on a nightly basis, specifically to look for Earths, and even more specifically to look for Earths in what's called the habitable zone, the zone near a star where liquid water might exist on the surface. And again, you know, grad students are totally involved in this because, you know, the professors are too busy teaching and being on committees and, you know, writing the proposals and stuff. So here's one of our students, Lauren Weiss, just monitoring what that robotic telescope is doing. And their biggest, most ambitious project is to monitor the roughly 100 stars within 20 light years to find potential Earths around the nearest stars, because those are the stars that we would have the best chance of observing in greater detail and or maybe someday in the future of humanity actually visiting, right? You don't want to find a planet that's a billion light years away. You want to find the nearby ones. And if we find Earth-like planets around the most nearby stars, then we'll know where to concentrate our efforts in the search for ET, to really answer once and for all whether Yoda really is out there, okay? Okay, one more brief science topic, you know, giant black holes in the centers of galaxies. A black hole is a region of space where matter has been compressed so much that the local gravity is strong enough to prevent anything from escaping. So, you know, water bottles can't escape, rockets can't escape, not even light can escape. So no light is emitted, no light is transmitted, no light is reflected. A black hole doesn't shine at all. So here's my prize-winning photograph of a black hole, you know, so the effect is better in a darkened room. So I sell this for $10,000, but you, special audience, $5,000, okay? Or you could keep the lens cover on your camera, or if you're using Keynote or PowerPoint, just choose a uniform black background. So there, I just gave away a trade secret. Okay, well, anyway, they suck you in and they hold on fiercely, abandon all hope, ye who enter here, from Dante's Inferno, of course. Well, astronomers have a saying, what happens in a black hole stays in a black hole, because, you know, none of the information is ever gonna get out. If not even light can get out, you know, nothing else will get out either. Well, how do we find these things, you know? Well, we could take a clue from our successful technique for searching for exploding stars. We could take repeatedly many photographs of the sky and simply look for arrows, and the arrows point to these black regions here. And those might be black holes, but I would venture to guess that most of those are not black holes. They're just spaces where there happens to be no star or no galaxy, you know? So, you know, it's not that easy. But what we can do is measure the black hole's effect on its environment. A black hole's gravity causes things near it to move quickly. And if we can measure the mass of an object, if something is orbiting around it, all we need to do is measure the orbital speed of that orbiting object and its distance from the center of attraction. And this little ball should be zipping around. For some reason, it's not. But if we know the orbital distance and the speed v, we can use Newton's laws. You don't even need Einstein's general theory of relativity to figure out the mass of the thing that's pulling on the other thing. Gravity, not just a good idea, it's the law. Okay, well, for decades now, we've had a candidate type of galaxy in which we suspected that black holes exist. They are galaxies called active galaxies. Normal galaxies have a concentration of stars toward the center. That's because the gravity pulls them there. But so-called active galaxies have an even greater concentration of light. Not necessarily stars, but see, this thing is really, really bright. The spikes are a telescopic artifact, all right? So there's something really bright in the center of this galaxy. And even back in the mid-1960s, it was theorized that what's going on there is that there's a giant black hole having millions or billions of times the mass of the sun, and it's sucking in material. And as that material falls in, usually by spiraling around, it converts its kinetic energy into radiated energy by rubbing against the neighboring material. And if you have a spinning black hole, that process is even more efficient. And so the environment of the black hole glows very brightly. The black hole isn't emitting any light, but the neighborhood, the environment of the black hole emits light very, very efficiently. And so it was theorized that that is why active galaxies look so bright. It's that there's a supermassive black hole which has gas in its environment that's glowing very, very brightly. Well, that hypothesis has considerable support by now, and we have at Lick Observatory obtained even more support. And by the way, I do not mean to imply that we are the only ones doing this kind of astronomical work. I mean, you know, a lot of the conclusions I've talked about were made by, you know, my colleagues working elsewhere, but you know, we work at different observatories and we verify findings, and that's the process by which science advances. I don't want to imply that my group is the only group of astrophysicists or, you know, Jeff Marcy or whatever. Nevertheless, our group has greatly supported this claim of black holes by gathering data repeatedly with this Kate object and by getting repeatedly spectra. The spectra can tell us the speed of the orbiting objects, and a combination of the spectra and the images tells us how far away they are from the center. I can't go into all those details, but we get the two things we need, speed and orbital distance, and we calculate how massive the object is that's causing the gas to whirl around. And again, students remotely observing from these facilities we now have at all the UC campuses have contributed greatly to this work. We've monitored a bunch of galaxies, here's several of them, and we do indeed find that there's gravitational evidence for a massive object, probably a supermassive black hole, in the middle of these galaxies. And so Einstein thought that black holes were simply an interesting mathematical oddity that could result from his equations of general relativity, but he did not think that black holes actually exist in nature. And imagine what his reaction would be if he were to see the evidence now that they really do exist. Could be something like that, right? Because he didn't think that they actually exist in nature, and now we have evidence that they really do exist in nature, and he would have been thrilled beyond belief. But again, to do this kind of work, you know, you need huge amounts of time on smallish telescopes or modest-sized telescopes. So these are three major science topics that are being addressed right now at Lick and have been addressed in the recent past, and they are continuing to be great focal points for us. I wanted to briefly mention technology development because that's another great thing we do at Lick. We can develop new instruments, test them, debug them, and once everything is working well, move them over to the big guns like the Keck telescopes. After all, why spend time on the Kecks debugging and fixing an instrument when the amortized cost of the Keck telescopes is roughly $100,000 a night? So any night that you've spent just debugging something, that effectively costs you $50,000 to $100,000, depending on how you do the calculation. So you might as well do it on a smaller telescope and then port it over. And the shining example of this that we've done at LIC is called laser guide star adaptive optics. The point is the following. You've all noticed that the stars twinkle at night. That's because the light is going through the atmosphere that corrupts the incoming waves and makes them sort of corrugated. And that leads to a twinkling effect and also a blurring effect. So through a telescope, stars don't look like points of light. They look like these fuzzy blobs. And instantaneously, if you take many, many images per second, that blob looks like what you see on the left there. That's what the atmosphere is doing to the incoming light, because the pockets of air are moving around every which way, and they have different density and different temperature and different water content. Yet you know the star is supposed to look like the thing on the right. Well, by making measurements hundreds of times a second, you can figure out how the wave got corrupted, and you can turn it into the image that you see on the right. And this correction factor then applies over a small patch of sky next to that star. So if you have a galaxy that looks fuzzy and you want to get a clearer image of it, and there happens to be a bright star next to that galaxy, you can monitor the incoming waves of that bright star many hundreds of times per second, apply the corrections to make that bright star look point-like, and that will then clarify the fuzzy image of the galaxy. It turns from this to that, applying adaptive optics. It's fantastic. We can essentially get rid of the atmosphere, but not be, you know, not strangled to death because of the lack of air here, you know. Well, that's cool, but you know, most galaxies don't happen to have a bright star next to them. What if you want to study that galaxy and you know, there's no bright star? There's a bright star, but it's not near that galaxy. So you're hosed. But it turns out you can create a fake star by shining a laser beam up into the atmosphere and exciting a layer of sodium atoms that lives up there about 100 kilometers up. It's interesting. It's brought in more or less continuously by micrometeorites, little meteors that come in and they have sodium and the sodium hangs around in the upper atmosphere. And by shining a laser beam at the sodium, you can cause it to glow and produce a fake star next to whatever object you want to study. And by monitoring the light waves coming from that fake star to us and making the mushed out mess look like a point and then applying those corrections to the object next to your laser guide star, you get a clear image of whatever you want in the sky. And this was developed and perfected on the 3-meter telescope at LIC, then ported over to the mighty Keck telescopes, making them the indisputable world leaders in using this technique, laser guide star adaptive optics, to learn interesting things about the universe. And so just to give you a few highlights, here's Io, one of the moons of Jupiter, before adaptive optics and after adaptive optics. This is the most volcanically active body in the solar system. It has more than 100 volcanoes going off simultaneously. Here's Uranus, and that is the correct pronunciation for anyone above the age of 6 or 7. Yes, you know, this is a planet that's the butt of many jokes, by the way. Anyway, here it is before adaptive optics. Here it is after adaptive optics. First of all, it has a ring. Okay, we didn't discover that. That was discovered long ago, but we can now study the ring from the ground. More importantly, we can study the development of storm systems on Uranus and hopefully come to a better understanding of storms and climate here on Earth. And then here's a picture toward the center of our Milky Way galaxy where everything looks fuzzy. There it is after you apply adaptive optics, lots of clear stars. In the little blue box in the center there is the middle of our galaxy. Two teams, one at Berkeley, one at UCLA, have been monitoring those stars for decades. And you know what? The stars go zoom, zoom, zoom. Professor Andrea Ghez and her group at UCLA have been one group of leaders, and Reinhard Genzel at Berkeley, in joint appointment with Max Planck Institute in Germany, have led the other team. Both have independently found that the stars are moving around something marked with a red cross there. And just applying Newton's laws of motion, you conclude that at the position of the red cross is something that has 4 million times the mass of the sun. And yet it's within a volume smaller than our solar system. The conservative conclusion is that it's a black hole. And it's appropriately marked with a red cross because, you know, black holes are kind of dangerous things. Okay, finally, but importantly, public outreach. Lick Observatory is the primary base for UC education and outreach efforts to the citizens of California and indeed the United States and international visitors as well. But of particular interest to California taxpayers, you know, a lot of Californians come up to Lick Observatory. You know, some take trips to Hawaii, but very few make it to the top of Mauna Kea. Most people are understandably sitting around on the beach sipping Mai Tais, okay? Lick is convenient. There it is on Google Maps or whatever, 14 miles east of San Jose, up a long and windy road. Take some Dramamine, but still, easy to reach. We have about 35,000 visitors a year, all right? There's a main hallway with various exhibits. There's some Joker explaining exploding stars and stuff. We have many volunteers that help us run free or just at a nominal cost summer programs where the general public can look through the great refractor, and while they're standing in line, others are in the lecture hall hearing a lecture about the latest research or looking through one of the other telescopes. And so it's just a great thing. Outside, we set up telescopes in cooperation with amateur astronomers. These kinds of programs inspire the youth and spark interest in science, in technology. I like to say that astronomy is the gateway science. It draws people in. Most of these kids will not become PhD astrophysicists. Again, that's okay. But they'll get interested in science and technology. They will pursue engineering, applied physics, computer science, other kinds of things like that, robotics, you know, biomedical fields, all kinds of stuff. But that early interest in science is fueled by all the amazing astronomical discoveries that are being made. I mean, it's like I was just talking to one of you during cocktail hour that hardly a day goes by that there isn't some announcement about astronomy somewhere in the newspaper. And every week or two, it's on the front page or one of the, you know, front few pages. So astronomy captures the public interest. And we have a big multiplicative factor as well because we now have a teacher training program where we teach the school teachers how data are taken and analyzed. Most school teachers do not have training in how data are actually taken and analyzed. And we give them a little bit of the training so they can then take it back and teach their students about real life science, not just the stuff you get in textbooks. And finally, of course, Lick is just a unique San Francisco Bay Area treasure and a place of great natural beauty, although we haven't had snow like this for probably a decade, okay? We had this pathetic storm last night. It did dump a little snow on Mount Hamilton, and so everyone goes zipping up there because half of San Jose hasn't seen snow. Anyway, it is a place of great natural beauty. So I hope I've shown you that it's really vital for research. Outstanding research has been done throughout its history. In this brief talk, I couldn't focus on what was done 100 years ago. It was more the modern stuff. But we're continuing to do really good stuff, especially for those types of projects that require giant amounts of time repetitively on telescopes. You just cannot get that time on the big guns. We do technology development, and something I didn't have a chance to mention, but graduate students and postdoctoral scholars like Sloan Viktorovich here can design their own instruments and test them. And you know, observers like me are a dime a dozen, and theorists are a dime a dozen. But people who also have real skills with their hands and building and testing equipment and figuring out what kinds of devices are going to possibly lead to the next breakthrough, they're really in great demand. So people like Sloan are, you know, hot commodities on the faculty job market. And they got a chance to do this at Lick, and at most universities, there isn't the opportunity to do this because they don't happen to have their own private observatory. Of course, we give hands-on training to graduate students and undergrads. I emphasize that a lot. And to postdoctoral scholars, through early exposure to research, they become the real leaders in many areas of science and technology, not just astrophysics. Grad students and postdocs can conduct their own research projects. They can be called what's called the principal investigator. It's one thing to join my group and initially be an apprentice, where you're largely helping with projects I have designed and for which I've obtained data, and I kind of even know where the answer is headed. That's an important part of their training, but an equally, if not more important part, is when I, at the appropriate time, set them loose and they design their own projects and implement them and conduct them from beginning to end with occasional help from me when necessary. This is what builds true independence, and we give them that opportunity at Lick Observatory, and that's something that can't be done if all you have available to you are the national facilities like the Hubble Space Telescope or only the big expensive facilities. And then finally, there's all the public education and outreach that we do in this amazing place. So it's really a great observatory, but, and there's always a but, as was mentioned by Jim, in September of 2013, the UC Office of the President, which in my opinion simply had not been properly educated about what it is we do at Lick and what an amazing place it is, they announced a plan to start reducing funding in 2016, ending by 2018. And given that this is a system-wide facility used by all of the campuses, no single chancellor had it at the top of his or her list. It really is something that has been and should be funded by the system-wide Office of the President, right? Because it's not only a facility of one or two campuses. It's a system-wide facility. So this was just a bad idea. It was just a really, really bad idea. And it was before Janet Napolitano stepped in. So she could have just, you know, said, well, forget this. And eventually she did, okay? But she needed to be properly educated. And a lot of people showed her and her staff and others in high places there, the second and third in command, that this is really important. I mean, I won't go through all these things, but we got congressional support. We got support from the state legislature. There was positive coverage in many important newspapers. Lots of people wrote in letters, not just students and postdocs, but members of the general public. People like you wrote letters in support of Lick. There were op-eds written, TV and radio programs. Anyway, the result was that on October 30th, 2014, the Office of the President sent a letter saying that, you know, they basically take back everything they said in the September 2013 letter. I mean, we won. All of us won. You know, all of you writing letters and stuff, you helped. They now are giving partial funding. They can't give the full amount because, you know, there's no secret that UC is under great financial strain. But they're not just cutting us off cold turkey. And the partial funding then means that we can get matching funds from other people. You know, and it also shows other corporations and individuals that, you know, this is a project that is important to the top brass. And that's an important point. If they didn't care, why should potential donors care? And then, in part because of this, by January of 2015, I basically single-handedly, I'm really quite proud of this. I mean, this part here was a lot of people doing, you know, doing a lot of work, in part me. But this, basically, I was discussing things with various people at Google, and one of them finally said, hey, you know, this is something that's right up our alley, in part because they understand that the future of their company rests on today's youth getting excited about science and technology. So they see the public outreach and education and the research training that we give as something that will be beneficial for them in the long run. And I'm hoping that Facebook and Apple and others, LinkedIn, will follow suit, and I am busy discussing things with them as well. Now, Google, of course, wants private donations to match this. They want their funds to be leveraged, okay? And, you know, it's a pretty good thing when a place like Google basically gives you a thumbs up. You know, Bill Gates and Warren Buffett and companies like Google and Microsoft and Facebook didn't get to where they are by being frivolous with their money. And so getting the stamp of approval from the big guns like this is really a great thing. You know, we have an operation cost of 1.5 to 2.5 million a year. It really is pretty small potatoes for such a productive and important educational and research facility. At 1.5 million a year, we can just keep things going, kind of limping along. At 2.5 million a year, we can become even better and design new technology. Many small gifts can reach that goal. Naming opportunities are there for more major gifts. And in fact, you know, the Holy Grail would be some $30 to $50 million endowment that would simply keep the place running in perpetuity. Okay, and that would be then, I don't know, the XYZ Institute of Astrophysics, of which Lick Observatory, the original main building, would be a subset. That's the only thing that legally needs to remain Lick Observatory, because there's a dead guy underneath there who said, so be it. But the rest of the facility could be called the XYZ Institute of Astrophysics, you know. And, you know, it doesn't have to be the endowment right away. It just, you know, it can come over a long time. But raising even a few million now tells our staff that we value them and that we're able to raise money and that their jobs are not in jeopardy. And, you know, if I were one of their staff up there, which I'm not, come 2015, like come now, I would have thought, gee, one of my job is the first to go. I better start looking for another job. They now are not quaking in their boots. They've seen the university partial support. They've seen the Google contribution. Various people have been sending in funds. And so we are going to keep our brightest and best like Eleanor Gates here. And, you know, if people like that were to leave, then even if we were to get the funding later on, it would be very difficult to hire such accomplished and knowledgeable people back. So I'm happy to say they see that we're on a winning road here, and so their confidence has been buoyed, and I'm really happy about that. So, you know, there are many reasons to want Lick to keep going. We want it to continue to thrive, and if you have ideas or suggestions, my email is out there, but it's an easy one, alex@astro.berkeley.edu. I'd love to hear from you. Just one little thing, since many of you are so favorably disposed toward Cal, tax-deductible donations are always something that we very much appreciate. And now, in particular, there's this Google matching challenge. They hope and really expect, I think, us to raise this money. And the hope is that the two-year agreement at $500,000 per year was just sort of a courtship period. And if we successfully work with them and are able to raise matching funds, the hope is that this will extend far, far into the future at the $500,000 or more level. So, you know, there's the UC Berkeley Foundation. Write to me if you don't want to get all this down. Maria Yelm is here. You can always email her. You can directly donate online, and so on and so forth. But all I wanted to end was with Go Bears. You know, we're doing great things at Lick, and it's partly thanks to you. And I'll be happy to take questions, and then after the Q&A period, I'll be happy to sign books and DVDs. If you didn't happen to bring a book or a DVD of mine with you, lo and behold, I'll have them out in the lobby, and I'll be happy to autograph them. So thank you very, very much. Great. And I know this is a Cal audience, so there's going to be some spectacular questions. Not to put the pressure on any of you. And by the way, I really shouldn't have said that. In my opinion, there's no such thing as a dumb question, because as I tell my students, if they ask that question, chances are lots of other people either had the same question or just didn't even think of it. It was so profound. So fire away at whatever you'd like, and I'll repeat the questions for the benefit of everyone. Yes. Yeah, so is smog a problem? And a corollary, are the city lights of the greater Bay Area, and San Jose in particular, Santa Clara Valley, a problem? Sure, smog and city lights are an issue. We are in a heavily populated area of the US. However, we choose projects which are least affected by those issues, okay? The city lights in particular drown out the light from the most distant stars and galaxies, and so I and others study relatively bright, relatively nearby stars and galaxies. And as I mentioned, the stars that are being searched for the presence of exoplanets are in many cases bright naked eye stars. And so, you know, you can see them even with a lot of light pollution. The smog is not as much of an issue just because usually there's an inversion layer and it keeps it trapped down pretty low. Occasionally smoke from fires or smog from the city will come up and will affect the visibility a little bit, but that's a relatively minor fraction of the time. The other thing I wanted to mention was that the lights of the cities are designed to operate at what we call visible or optical wavelengths, because humans see at those wavelengths. But astronomers are interested as well in the infrared, and it turns out that the infrared sky at Lick is quite dark, comparable to the Mauna Kea sky in Hawaii. So we are now building more instruments and doing more projects that focus on the infrared, where we are essentially not at all affected by the city lights. So great question, because I've sometimes met people who said that, well, they thought LIC was all washed up because of the presence of cities. But we just do those programs that aren't affected by the cities very much. Okay? So good one. All right. Next question. How do I grasp infinity? I don't, to tell you the honest truth. And, you know, it reminds me of a joke. Woody Allen said in one of his movies, eternity is an awfully long time, especially near the end, right? So infinity, eternity, these are tough concepts, but just to titillate your intellectual senses a little bit, let me just give you a few interesting facts about infinity. There's the 1, 2, 3, and so on, counting numbers. Then there's the fractions, the rational fractions like 1 fifth and 7 18ths and things like that. Between 0 and 1, I can think of an infinite number of rational fractions. And between 1 and 2, an infinite number. And between 2 and 3, an infinite number as well. So is the set of rational fractions a bigger infinity or the same size as the counting numbers? Turns out, it's the same size. And you might say, well, sure, infinity is just infinity. But I have two things to say about this. You know, first of all, that statement, infinity and just infinity, isn't completely self-evident, because if I have an infinite number between 0 and 1 and an infinite number between 1 and 2, you know, I eventually have a matrix infinity times infinity. And in a sense, you know, isn't that a bigger infinity? Well, no, it turns out not to be. However, there are bigger infinities. Anyone know a very simple one of them? Pi, yeah, numbers like pi, exactly right. Irrational numbers, those that cannot be expressed as a rational fraction. No matter what numbers you conjure up, you will never get all digits of pi by forming a rational fraction. Another such number is e. It turns out that those numbers plus the rational numbers form the real number line, and that is a bigger infinity than just the counting numbers. But I don't really grasp any of this very well, other than just repeating what someone else told me. Next question, you know. yes, right here. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so is any of the budget at LIC used for asteroid hunting? Not specifically to my knowledge. Years ago, there was a wide-angle camera that was taking rather big pictures of the sky that would then show an asteroid at several stages of its trajectory, and then you can actually calculate what its orbit is, and with enough points on subsequent nights, you could then refine the trajectory and figure out whether it's ever going to hit us. That wide-angle camera is not in use very much anymore, in part because such cameras are more subject to light pollution than when you look at a very narrow, very small portion of the heavens, okay? So that's a project that just isn't as suitable at LIC. There are ways that we can get around this problem of the light pollution, even for those kinds of cameras, when we're clever about it. And maybe someday someone will do that. Given the growing interest in finding the killer asteroids, that may be a lucrative form of funding from the federal government, because they have now mandated that astronomers find essentially all of the asteroids bigger than 1 kilometer in diameter. Those are the ones which, if they were to hit the Earth, would cause global changes in civilization. Not quite a mass extinction, but global changes in civilization. And the ones that are about 100 meters and above would cause very large regional damage. So the hope would be that someday we will catalog all of those as well. But those are smaller and hence fainter. So there, you know, the federal government is actually, you know, making funds available. So you just gave me a good idea. Thank you very much. I'll propose maybe another question there. I thought I saw a hand over there. Yes, right there. Mm-hmm. Yes.
We will never get to the back of the moon or never get to Mars.
Yeah, so yeah.
About
oh, well, you know, so the point that's being made is in our lifetimes, we're unlikely to get back to the moon or to Mars. So who cares about, you know, the stars? Well, you know, first of all, This is one of the things that sets humans apart from all other types of animals that we know of, is that we do have these advanced brains that can ask questions and pursue their answers just for the fun of it, you know? And if some subset of society did not do this, then in a sense I feel that humans would be selling themselves short. They would be, in a sense, not living up to the potential, to the expectations of the Homo sapien species, you know. And I feel very privileged to be in that small segment of the world population that is privileged to ask these questions. But we care also in part because you never know what the practical spin-offs will be. For example, a century ago, Einstein and Bohr and Heisenberg and Schrodinger were developing quantum physics with not the slightest practical application in mind. Fast forward one century with all your lasers and electronic gadgets and a trillion transistors at the head of a pin. You need to know quantum physics. You need to know microphysics. Back then, they just simply wanted to understand why atoms exist and the nature of light. That's what their goal was. No practical applications, but now you cannot imagine life today without an understanding of that microphysics. And thirdly, it excites kids. Knowing about the stars excites kids, and they then go into fields that are more immediately useful to society. But yes, just because we don't know of any practical application of the stars right now doesn't mean there will never be one, and we certainly know from polls that kids get excited by astronomy and move into technical fields. And then finally, we hope that Homo sapiens will go far, far beyond just the next couple of generations. I mean, right? If we are around for the next million years, who knows what we will achieve? A century ago, going to the moon, or even flying a little bit more than a century ago, was considered nonsense. And look what we've achieved, right? So someday, we may get to the stars. Yes?
You got the magic number of what, $50 million.
Yeah, $50 million would do us in, I mean, you know, the Ellison Institute of Astrophysics or whatever, you know? Yeah. Yeah, am I restricted politically? Maybe in some cases, but if we just happen to meet at a dinner party and, you know, people ask me what I do and, you know, and I say I'm an astronomer and we start talking about this, I think those kinds of things are fair game. The bigger problem is that in most of these cases, right, the people are just surrounded by this cloak of impenetrability, and I just can't reach them, right? I mean, who am I to them? In some cases, I actually have personal friends who do have at least the capacity or partly the capacity to help out, and I've had a number of private donors that have helped my research group, and I'm eternally grateful to them. And there are foundations as well, I forgot to mention, but the spectrograph I use to get spectra of supernovae is showing its age, and we've figured out all kinds of interesting ways to improve it. And I'm proud to say that the Heising-Simons Foundation recently gave $300,000 to an improvement of that spectrograph and stuff. So there are various avenues, but I don't have necessarily access to the 100 billionaires in Silicon Valley because everyone's going after them. And there are many, many, many very worthwhile causes in society. And, you know, I'll be the first to admit that. And this is not even the most important, you know, but this is one of the ones that I think is worthy of support. And there are enough people out there, there's enough wealth in California and beyond that I think all these things can be supported. It's just that, it's hard to reach the right people. Yes, right there. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So what do I think the dark matter is? And I'll mention dark energy as well. So first of all, I didn't have much time to talk about it, but dark matter is stuff that is gravitationally attractive, but that you do not see. And we know it's there because galaxies are spinning, and they're spinning so quickly that they would fly apart unless there were extra gravity there pulling them in. And yet we don't see the mass that would be responsible for that gravity. So we call it dark matter, all right? It's the stuff that's there, causing a galaxy to be gravitationally bound, but we don't see it. So the best buy model for the dark matter now is that it's not mostly black holes. Part of it could well be black holes, right? Because they don't emit light, but they do gravitationally pull, or other types of dead stars. You know, they contribute to dark matter. But we think most of the dark matter is some exotic type of particle left over from the time of the Big Bang, 13.8 billion years ago. And generically, the most likely candidates are known as WIMPs, weakly interacting massive particles, WIMPs, as opposed to the machos, massive compact halo objects like black holes and dead stars. So it's the machos versus the WIMPs. The WIMPs theoretically are winning because the observations just don't support most of the machos being the constituents of dark matter, and there are theoretical reasons for thinking that the WIMPs are. But in terms of direct detection, we're in bad shape. People have been looking for 20 years for WIMPs and have not yet found them. Professor Bernard Satterlee at Cal, you know, has one of the leading experiments in the world to look for WIMPs, and he has not yet found them. This doesn't mean they're not there. They're just very, very difficult to detect. I'm becoming mildly concerned, but I'm not yet willing to give up the theory of dark matter. If in 20 years we still haven't detected the WIMPs, then it'll be back to the drawing board. Dark energy, the even more dominant constituent of the universe, you tell me and we'll both know. Let's write a paper together, and if we're right, maybe we'll win the Nobel Prize, okay? More seriously, the dark energy might be the zero point energy of the vacuum. And the reason Einstein was surprised on that Science magazine cover story when we were, you know, the single most important breakthrough in 1998 was that he proposed a zero point energy to the vacuum back in 1917 and then sort of renounced his idea for as observations became better. And he never really liked the idea because it meant that the vacuum is not pure energy, is not purely zero. But it turns out that the vacuum might have a non-zero energy, and that's a really bizarre thing. But even if it's not the zero-point energy of the vacuum, it might be some new type of energy field, and Higgs fields and the Higgs boson have been in the news lately. It would be a Higgs-like field, a new type of energy field, not the energy field that gives mass to all other particles, which is what the Higgs is, but some other generic type of Higgs field that would cause this anti-gravity. It would be a field that originates at the quantum level but has repercussions for the dynamics of the universe as a whole. So in that sense, it would unify the two great pillars of modern physics: quantum physics, which works great for atoms and molecules, and general relativity, which works great, you know, for black holes and stars and planets and stuff. But when you try to bring these two pillars of modern physics together, they are at war with one another because we do not yet have a fully self-consistent quantum theory of gravity. Maybe string theory will be successful, maybe not. But any quantum theory of gravity that's successful would, as a requirement, have to explain the accelerating expansion of the universe, because that now appears to be an observed fact. So we have now set constraints for the quantum gravity experts. Okay, one more question, very good. And then we'll I'll be happy to be in the lobby there. So who wants to give me a doozy? I'm not see, if there's a hand in the back, I don't see, oh, there's one right there, okay. These lights are just really bright.
Just one more question.
Yeah.
Oh,
the funding challenge, sure.
So with the advent of private companies like Elon Musk's SpaceX, right?
Yeah.
Theoretically, at least.
Right.
Reducing the cost of space travel. Do you see a future in the next, I don't know, 10, 20, 30 years where orbiting space-based telescopes begin to really obsolesce land-based?
Yeah, yeah. So, you know, would orbiting telescopes make ground-based telescope essentially obsolescent? And I think not, because the space telescopes are always much more expensive than the ground-based telescopes. And so they should be used to do only those projects that can be done from space, like looking at ultraviolet wavelengths. The ozone in our atmosphere, it's good for us, you know, blocks the ultraviolet light from the sun from coming through, and that greatly decreases the rate at which mutations occur. So, you know, for ultraviolet, you want to go into space and stuff. But for certain types of projects, like monitoring the wobble of a star in response to a planet orbiting it, that can be done just as well, if not better, from the ground. So why not do those kinds of observations from the ground? So I think it will always be the case that launching stuff is more expensive than just keeping stuff on the ground. I just can't conceive that launching stuff is going to become dirt cheap anywhere in the near future. And if it does become cheap, then I claim we should launch big, huge things that have the capacity to travel to distant stars, and we shouldn't waste our time, you know, with little tiny telescopes and stuff. So I favor some number of space telescopes, and indeed I have this proposal deadline coming up. But that also goes back to one other question, and that is the seeking of funding and the billionaires and stuff. And I just thought of something that I should have mentioned, and that is that, you know, there are some tensions here, there's no doubt, because, you know, in the University of California, we are partners in the 30-meter telescope. And the Gordon and Betty Moore Foundation has given Caltech and UC each $125 million. So that's $250 million total out of the anticipated $1.2 or $1.3 billion. So that's a great start. And it's the early money, which is very important money, right? And now we've assembled this international collaboration. Well, as part of that agreement with the Moore Foundation, the University of California agreed that we would raise $50 million. Okay? That's pretty good. They gave $125. They're only asking us to raise $50. What is that? You know, 2.5 to 1 matching. That's pretty good, you know. Gosh, that's not even 1 to 1. So we have to raise $50 million. So I must admit that some of my colleagues are more focused on the importance of the 30-meter telescope. And it's not that I'm against it. I'm for it. But I'm also trying to argue for the little guy, you know, the students and also for the projects that don't necessarily need that giant telescope. And again, I'm for the 30-meter telescope. I just think that for relatively small amounts of money, 1 to 2 or 3 million a year, you can run LIC. Or for an endowment as big as our contribution to the 30-meter, you can run LIC in perpetuity. And in my estimation, the overall benefit to the University of California of doing that is as high as having a small 12.5% share of the 30-meter telescope. That's my opinion. But it is not necessarily shared by all of my colleagues. And some of them point out that if and when we do go after the billionaires, we have to go after them with one unified front, with one big sexy project. And so they have not been entirely happy with my pounding the pavement for Lick Observatory. But I felt passionate about pounding the pavement for the reasons I've tried to articulate this evening. But there definitely are some tensions. And one way I get around those is by saying, okay, look, I've never asked Gordon and Betty Moore for the $50 million. Pretty good idea, actually. Are Gordon and Betty in the audience, by the way? Anyway, so, but you know, I'm not necessarily competing with the people that do have the approval of the president of the University of California and the various chancellors, right? For those highest echelon things, I probably do need approval, unless I happen to be a personal friend and we're having a beer late in the night and they say, hey, what's new in the cosmos and would you like me to write out a check for $50 million? You know, I mean, you don't say no to an offer like that, unless it was raised in dubious ways, like through the mafia or something like that. But so there are some sensitivities going back to the question, a very good question that was asked a little while ago. Well, thank you very much. You've been a great audience, and I'll go outside there. So, yeah.